This is your hip bone. It has all of these parts and surface landmarks that serve as muscle attachments, pathways for nerve and vessels, and protection for the organs inside of your pelvis. The hip bone is the first topic in our lower limb skeletal series. So in this video, we're going to go through what is considered the pelvis, the pelvic planes, and then break down all three parts of the hip bone, the surfaces and landmarks. Then we will talk a little bit about the articulations around, like the sacroiliac joint, the pubic symphysis, and so on. What's up everyone? My name is Taim. I'm a medical doctor and I make animated medical lectures to make different topics in medicine visually easier to understand. If you would like a PDF version or a quiz of this presentation, you can find it on my website, along with organized video lectures to help with your studies. Alright, let's get started. So what is the pelvis? Think of the pelvis as the central bridge between the spine and the lower limbs. Anatomically, the pelvis consists of three bones: the right hip bone, the left hip bone, and the sacrum. Together, these three form the bony pelvis. But there is an anatomical concept that helps us make sense of this area, and that is the linea terminalis, or also known as the pelvic brim. This is a curved bony ridge that loops from the sacral promontory at the back, along the arcuate line of the ilium, down to the pectin pubis, and ends at the top of the pubic symphysis. This ridge forms the pelvic inlet. Everything above the pelvic inlet is referred to as the greater pelvis, which is also called false pelvis. It supports abdominal organs like the small intestines and the sigmoid colon. Everything below the inlet is called the lesser pelvis, also known as true pelvis, and it contains the bladder, reproductive organs, and rectum. Now, if we cut the pelvis right about here and look at it from this view, we will see this sagittal view. As you see here, the pelvic inlet starts from the sacral promontory, curves along the arcuate line of the ilium, and goes all the way towards the superior border of the pubic symphysis. Now, why am I babbling about this before I talk about the hip bone anatomy? Let me explain. This opening is clinically important, especially in obstetrics, because it defines the entrance to the true pelvis, the space a fetus must pass through during vaginal delivery. And to assess if that passage is even possible, we study a set of diameters of the pelvic inlet. These diameters are a part of standard obstetric evaluation. They help estimate whether labor is likely to progress normally or if C-section might be required. Now, I will go through some of the most important ones here, and I will cover them in more detail in the PDF written version that goes along with this video. First is the transverse diameter. This is the widest horizontal span of the pelvic inlet. It goes from one side of the pelvic brim to the other, and it's usually about 13 centimeters in an average female pelvis. Next is the oblique diameter. It runs diagonally from the sacroiliac joint on one side to the iliopectineal eminence on the opposite side. Its length is slightly longer, roughly 13.5 centimeters. And then there's the anatomical conjugate, which is the straight line from the sacral promontory to the upper border of the pubic symphysis. This one is critical because it reflects the antero-posterior diameter of the pelvic inlet. It typically measures around 11 to 12 centimeters, but clinically, we often estimate the obstetric conjugate instead, since the anatomical conjugate can't be measured directly during pelvic exam. Now, if you look from underneath, from the inferior view, we can see another important boundary, and that is the pelvic outlet. This is the lower opening of the true pelvis. What's really interesting about the pelvic outlet is that it is divided into two triangles: the urogenital triangle at the front and the anal triangle at the back. These triangles aren't just shapes for your visual memory, they reflect the orientation of muscles, fascia, and clinical zones. For example, when a woman is giving birth, sometimes a surgical cut has to be done to enlarge the vaginal opening and facilitate delivery. This is called episiotomies, and this is performed in the perineal region that lies right across these triangles. So that is the pelvis. It's a bony ring formed by the right and left hip bones and the sacrum, divided into the greater and the lesser parts by the pelvic brim, and functionally defined by the inlet and outlet. Now, let's go ahead and isolate the hip bone. The hip bone itself consists of three fused parts: the ilium, the pubis, and the ischium. Let's go through the major landmarks of each, starting with the ilium. The ilium is generally divided into the ala of the ilium and the body. Ala is the wing of the ilium, and the body is the smaller caudal part of the ilium. Right here at the top, we have this broad curved edge we call the iliac crest. This is the one that's easily palpable on the sides of your hips. If we trace the crest forward, we get to the anterior superior iliac spine, and this spine serves as an attachment site for the tensor fasciolata, sartorius muscle, and the inguinal ligament. This is also the landmark we use when measuring the leg length clinically. If we rotate the ilium to the back, we now see the posterior aspect of the iliac crest. What's fascinating here is that this crest is divided into three zones: the outer lip, intermediate, and the inner lip. Now, why do we bother naming these? Because different muscle groups attach to different parts of this crest. And you can see here, for example, how these abdominal muscles sit on distinct regions. The external oblique inserts at the outer lip, the internal oblique anchors to the intermediate zone, and the transversus abdominis, the deepest one of the three, originates from the inner lip. Other examples are the thoracolumbar fascia, which attaches medially, blending with the inner lip as it anchors into the lumbar spine. We can see the gluteus maximus attaching to the outer lip, while the gluteus medius sits a bit higher up on the gluteal surface, but still near the crest. And there is the tensor fasciolata, which continues its course along the anterior part of the iliac crest, blending into the iliotibial tract. So that was the crest. Another structure we can appreciate along the crest is the tuberculum of the iliac crest. It serves as the thickest part of the crest, and it is actually where the iliotibial tract attaches. I talked about these muscles in the videos about the muscles of the thigh. If we now look posteriorly, we can see the posterior superior iliac spine. Just below that is the posterior inferior iliac spine. Both of these spines contribute to the posterior border of the auricular surface. But if we now rotate back to the anterior view, just below the anterior superior iliac spine, we've got the anterior inferior iliac spine. This serves as the origin point for the rectus femoris muscle, one of the quadriceps muscles. It is also the site where parts of the iliofemoral ligament attaches, which is a crucial stabilizer of the hip joint that resists hyperextension. Just medial to that, we see the iliac fossae. This broad surface is where the iliacus muscle originates. You can see how it sits right into the fossae, joining with the psoas major further down to form the iliopsoas, the strongest hip flexor. If we follow along the inner surface, there's a curved bony ridge known as the arcuate line. This marks the boundary between the ala and the body of the ilium, and form parts of the pelvic brim we talked about earlier. Just behind this area is the iliac tuberosity, a roughened patch of bone where the strong ligaments of the sacroiliac joint attach. Directly below is the auricular surface, shaped like an ear, and this is the actual articular surface that connects with the sacrum. Now, if we go back to the posterior view again, this broad outer surface of the ilium is called the gluteal surface, and there are three lines running across this surface: the posterior gluteal line, the anterior gluteal line, and the inferior gluteal line. The reason we have these is because this is where the gluteal muscles originates: gluteus maximus, medius, and minimus. And to help us map out their zones of origin, we have three lines running across this surface. The posterior gluteal line separates the area where the gluteus maximus originates from that of the gluteus medius. The anterior gluteal line marks the border between the gluteus medius and gluteus minimus. And the inferior gluteal line defines the lower boundary where the gluteus minimus arises. Another landmark in this region that we can point out is the supraacetabular groove. This little depression just above the acetabulum serves as the origin point for the reflected head of the rectus femoris. And that brings us to the acetabulum, the socket of the hip joint. It is composed of several parts. The acetabular margin forms the rim, and at the bottom you have the acetabular notch, which remains incomplete until bridged by the transverse acetabular ligament. The lunate surface is the curved articular part that the femoral head actually contacts, and the acetabular fossae is the central non-articular area filled with fat and the ligament of the head of the femur. All of these help form the hip joint, where the head of the femur goes right within the acetabulum. So that was everything we are going to cover for the ilium. Now, let's move on to the next part of the hip joint, the pubis. The pubis is divided into three main parts: the superior pubic ramus, the body, and the inferior pubic ramus. Let's start here with the body. On the anterior surface of the body, we can find the pubic tubercle. This small projection serves as an important attachment point for both the inguinal ligament and the superior pubic ligament. Just medial to the tubercle is the pubic crest, and right next to it is the symphysial surface. The pubic crest is a ridge that provides insertion for the rectus abdominis and just lateral to that, origin for the pyramidalis muscle. The symphysial surface, the flat articular area, contributes to the pubic symphysis, which unites the two pubic bones at the midline. Running along the upper border of the superior pubic ramus is the pectin pubis, also known as the pectineal line. This surface is the origin for the pectineus muscle, and it is also where both the lacunar ligament and the pectineal ligament are found. If you want to know more about them, see my topography of the hip video, so we can focus on the bony landmarks in this video. If we rotate the view a little bit, we can see the obturator crest, which is this raised bony margin just above the obturator foramen. The obturator crest helped define the path of the obturator nerve and vessels, which pass through the small opening in the obturator membrane. That's the fibrous sheath covering most of the obturator foramen. So that was all the structures I wanted to show for the pubis. Let's now move on to the next part, which is the ischium. The ischium consists of two parts, the body and the ramus of the ischium. And here from the medial view, you can see that the body of the ischium is quite large. It spans the upper portion and forms part of the acetabulum. One of the first landmarks we should highlight here is the ischial tuberosity. This is a really important surface because it serves as a common origin or insertion for multiple muscles and ligaments. These include the sacrotibious ligaments, ischiofemoral ligament, and several muscles, semitendinosus, semimembranosus, long head of the biceps femoris, adductor magnus, quadratus femoris, and inferior gemellus. So when you hear someone say that the hamstrings originate from the ischial tuberosity, this is the exact spot they're talking about. In this same region, we can also identify the lesser sciatic notch, the greater sciatic notch, and the ischial spine that sits between them. These are part of the topographical landscape of the posterior pelvis. I'll go over this in more detail in the video on pelvic topography, but the key idea is that these structures are transformed by ligaments, the sacrotuberous and the sacrospinous ligaments, into two passageways, the greater sciatic foramen and the lesser sciatic foramen. These foramina are gateways for important nerves and vessels that travels to and from the gluteal region. Alright, so that was everything I wanted to cover for the ischium. Now, the last thing I wanted to talk about are the articulations of the pelvis. The first one is the sacroiliac joint. This joint is formed between the auricular surface of the sacrum and the auricular surface of the ilium. These surfaces interlock tightly, and the joint is surrounded by a short but extremely strong capsule. It is further reinforced by several ligaments. The main ones you will see here are the posterior sacroiliac ligament and the anterior sacroiliac ligament. But there's also a deep interosseous sacroiliac ligament. This one sits between the bones and is one of the strongest ligaments in the entire body, and it plays a role in stabilizing the sacroiliac joint under load. The next articulation is right here, the pubic symphysis. This is a cartilaginous joint that unites the two pubic bones at the midline. It is supported by the superior pubic ligament running across the top and the inferior pubic ligament down here at the bottom. These ligaments work together to provide stability during movement like walking and changes in posture. Other important ligaments in this region include the sacrotuberous ligament and the sacrospinous ligament. These were mentioned earlier, but just to recap, they span between the sacrum and the ischium, and they help convert the greater and lesser sciatic notches into the greater sciatic foramen and the lesser sciatic foramen, respectively, forming passageways for structures entering and leaving the pelvis. Lastly, let's not forget the obturator membrane, which spans from the obturator foramen, leaving just a small canal called the obturator canal through which the obturator nerve and vessels pass. So that wraps up everything I wanted to cover about the pelvis and hip bone. I really hope all of that made sense. The next video is going to be about the joint that sits right about in this area, the hip joint. So if you want to learn more about how the femur interacts with the acetabulum and what ligaments and movements are involved, go ahead and click the next video and I will see you there. If you want handmade PDF version of this lecture, take a quiz to test your knowledge, or access an organized list of all my videos, you can find everything on my website. Thanks for watching, see you in the next one.